بلادك خيبين القلوب مفتوحة وبضي العينين لا تنامي يما بلادك خيبين بقلوب مفتوحة وبضي العينين لا تخافي يما بلادك رجعي.
Good evening. Hello. Good evening or good afternoon. My name is Anat Matar and I will be moderating today's lecture. Before we start, let me pass the microphone on to Ahmed Abbes, who will instruct those who need the Arabic translation how this works. So, Ahmed, please.
شكرا عنيت. المتابعون على زوم والذين يفضلون الاستماع إلى المحاضرة بالترجمة الفورية إلى اللغة العربية يرجى النقر على أيقونة الترجمة في أسفل الشاشة التي تمثلها الكرة الأرضية واختيار العربية. هذا الخيار غير متاح لمستمعي الفيسبوك. شكرا جزيلا لنمير قسيس الذي يقدم الترجمة الفورية.
شكرا أحمد. We are currently in the worst, lowest point since these lectures had started. Indeed, since I remember myself, each day brings more horrible and heartbreaking news. We have just seen in the opening clip, Gaza is a thriving seaside city. What has remained after 9 weeks of systematic destruction we saw in other clips? In these dark days, we are honored to have with us Professor Etienne Balibar, who will address the present situation directly. Etienne is Emeritus Professor of Philosophy at the University of Paris-Nanterre, an anniversary chair of contemporary European philosophy at Kingston University, London, and he's also a visiting professor at Columbia University in New York. Etienne is the author of and co-author of 11 books. Among them I'll mention is particularly relevant in our context, The Philosophy of Marx, 1995, this is always relevant, Politics and the Other Scene, 2002, Violence and Civility, 2015, and Secularism and Cosmopolitanism, 2018. After Balibar's talk, there will be a question and answer session. So please post your questions by writing them in the chat box. I hope we'll have time to address all of them or most of them. Etienne, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you hear me? Thank you, Anat. Thank you so much. Thank you. I'm very touched, very, very moved. So, dear colleagues and dear listeners, I have accepted without hesitation, but with some concern, I must say, the invitation to deliver this Bissan lecture, which is a great honor for me. We are, as you just reminded us, in the middle of a savage war waged by the State of Israel against the population of Gaza and more generally the Palestinian people, with thousands of adults and a monstrous number of children already killed and many more maimed. 2 million people are being pushed out of their homes, only to find themselves again under the bombings on the roads. Whole urban areas are transformed into rubble. Schools, hospitals, universities, mosques, churches, theaters, administrative buildings, archaeological sites. In short, a whole society is destroyed forever. Against every law of civilization and international conventions, supplies of food, water, fuel, and medical necessities have been barred access to the population. The United Nations warns of an imminent humanitarian catastrophe of historic magnitude if it is not already there. Let me then be very clear. Palestinians from all parts of the country or from abroad hardly need to be lectured about this situation and its responsibilities. They know it only too well. They also have their views, perhaps multiple, about which outcome could be sought if there remains one, something we probably should not deny even in the most desperate moment. I never thought I should speak for the Palestinians, much less instead of them. I thought I should speak to them with my own words and in harmony with other intellectuals in the world to express our solidarity and commitment to doing whatever is in our capacity to stop the massacre and help liberate the people of Palestine. But it also occurred to me that I should seize the occasion offered by your hospitality to speak to myself, as it were, trying to clarify what makes it that the current episode in the 100 years war on Palestine, as historian Rashid Khalidi has called it, reveals a new pattern of murderous conflicts and political aporias, or problems without solution, without immediate solution, which will affect the condition of all mankind. This is what led me to the hazardous project of comparing the war on Ukraine and the war on Palestine, which are taking place at two edges or frontiers of the Euro-Mediterranean space and partially involve the same actors. Think, I'll return to that, of the continuous supply of American weapons to both sides. It seemed to me that from the vantage point of what is happening now in Palestine, some of the implications of the Russian-Ukrainian war can be more clearly identified, and that in light of what is unfolding in Ukraine, the articulation of local, indigenous historical characters and more global, or as I like to say, cosmopolitical determinations in the war of Palestine could be interrogated in a meaningful manner. Of course, I am aware that in addition to the errors that I will make inevitably, there is here a danger of artificially superimposing upon one another heterogeneous situations which raise different problems of genealogy, collective identity, statehood, military strategy, rights, international effects. The singularity of each situation ought never to be blurred for the sake of generalization. I will try and keep this danger in my mind while asking you to accept the comparison as a working hypothesis and an analytic instrument. I trust that it will not detract us from the urgency that in both cases calls for resolute political commitment. As a preliminary step, I want to justify my use of the term extermination in the title that was announced. I already received some queries and objections, even objections about this choice, which regard both its definition and its range of applicability. To speak of extermination means that we include in the characterization or the definition of a war its destructive effects on populations, be they made of civilians or soldiers, or a mixture of both. Therefore, we discard immediately the misleading terminology of so-called collateral damage. Yes. Within given limits of territory and time, excuse me, I'm not even quite finished with a kind of bronchitis. So, within given limits of territory and time, this may range from targeted massacres to the destruction of the environment with all its inhabitants, or most of them. Whether or not this was part of their plan, and I tend to believe it was, Hamas on October 7th committed extremist massacres in its assault on the Israeli kibbutzim and festivals, which seemed to replicate, after decades, the massacres perpetrated by the Jewish paramilitaries on Palestinian villages during the Nakba. But the current destruction of Gaza is of completely different proportions. From one day to the next, if there is no ceasefire, if the borders remain sealed, the humanitarian aid remains blocked, and perhaps epidemics develop, it could turn into one of the worst killings since World War II. The Russian troops invading Ukraine certainly committed massacres in Ukrainian villages, as in Bucha, and reduced the city of Mariupol into rubble, just as they had done previously in Chechnya, in Grozny. They continuously target civilian neighborhoods with missiles and bombs. And although the exact figures are covered with military secret, it seems that the protracted war of position, reminiscent of the trenches of World War I, in which Ukrainian and Russian troops are now stuck, amounts to a mutual process of extermination, sometimes called attrition in military jargon, meaning that the outcome will be decided by the capacity of the two peoples to accept the decimation of their youth. Of course, this exterminist character is nothing new. In the past, it characterized armed conflicts, which became total wars, notably the two world wars, whose figures remain out of reach, but have been approached proportionately to the population in local conflicts, such as the Iran-Iraq war in the 1980s. It also characterized colonial wars, such as the War of Algeria waged by the French or the Vietnam War waged by the US. We are impressed by the return of so-called high-intensity conflicts, which had been declared a thing of the past. And we are concerned by the fact, to which I will also return, that Ukraine and Palestine appear as conflicts without diplomatic solution in a predictable future, leaving the door open to various forms of escalation. Is this the right speed? Is it okay for the translation? Yes? Okay. Now, the discussion about the character of the wars cannot remain enclosed in such descriptive formulas, because the moral, juridical and political issues that are involved, because of the moral, juridical and political issues that are involved. Two more controversial categories have been invoked, which are heavily overdetermined: terrorism and genocide. I must try and clarify my position on their legitimate use in both cases. As for terrorism, the situation is complicated by the widespread, but in my opinion, inconsistent rejection of the idea that a movement or organization could be at the same time a movement of resistance and make use of terrorist methods. An idea which derives from the fact that every state that confronts armed resistance or insurrections labels them terrorist in order to delegitimize it. It is made worse by the fact that since the attacks of 9/11, 2001, and the subsequent war on terror, lists of terrorist organizations have been issued by various countries and institutions including the United States, the European Union, but also Russia and the United Nations, Israel, of course, which means that organizations or movements are declared outlaws and negotiations are impossible with them officially, at least. They become absolute enemies, which can only be combated and destroyed. But this is a logic in which states are at the same time party and judge. I think that we must restart from a description of the actions themselves to attempt a characterization of the forces or institutions which carry them. Hamas is a long-standing organization of resistance of the Palestinian people with a religiously based ideology like many others in the past or the present, a complex history of rivalries with others, a strategy oscillating between violent and non-violent actions, and a capacity to elicit support in the population. I understand why Palestinian intellectuals and others explain that facing a total war waged in Gaza, they cannot dissociate themselves from Hamas, even when they disagree with its ideology or its strategy. And I understand why the public opinion in the Arab world and beyond chooses to isolate the aspect of heroic challenge to their powerful enemy, albeit sometimes at the cost of denying the most disturbing facts in the assault. Nevertheless, I see the massacre on October 7th involving various atrocities perpetrated against civilians as a pure terrorist action, also in the literal sense meant to spread terror, which forces us to confer a terrorist character upon the organization itself. However, if we look at the actions committed since decades towards the Palestinian population by the State of Israel, and before it by the Zionist militias, or today in the West Bank by colonists helped by the army, there's no way we can escape the conclusion that Israel is a terrorist state, just as Russia was a terrorist state in Chechnya, the US was a terrorist state in Iraq, France in Algeria and other colonies, etc. The symmetry does not justify the terrorist method in my eyes, nor does it prevent it from harming the cause of the resistance in the long run. Only it provides a necessary context for the interpretation of what happened and in which sense we can use certain terms. Perhaps the issue of genocide is even more complicated, but it is no less crucial for our evaluation of the situations that we face. In the first place, we must be aware of the extent to which the tragic history of the two regions and the two conflicts is haunted by the memory of the greatest genocides of the 20th century, the models that they have created for the evaluation of extreme violence, and the function that they have acquired to cement collective identities of survivors. The Holocaust of European Jews, perpetrated by Nazi Germany throughout Europe with the help of other fascist regimes, and the planned starvation to death of millions of Soviet peasants, most of which were Ukrainians, also targeted because of their nationality, today known as Holodomor. These memories are instrumentalized in Israel and in a different manner in Ukraine as well. But they are real traumas transmitted from generation to generation, generating contradictory effects which range from the anxiety of repetition to the projection of the image of the past executioners on present enemies. This is a process with extremely ambivalent results to be investigated with the help of such psychoanalytic notions as the death drive and the transference of the trauma from the victims to their own victims. Edward Said once wrote that the tragic fate of the Palestinians is to have become the victims of the victims. But if we concentrate on our two battlefields as they appear in the present, there seems to emerge a clear dissymmetry. The Russian propaganda has argued that Ukraine was carrying on a genocide in the eastern region, mainly inhabited by Russophones, the Donbass. And many Ukrainians tend to describe the intentions of the Russian invasion as a continuation of the Holodomor. In the first case, the category is clearly irrelevant. If there were systematic violences committed. In the second case, the correct term, it seems to me, would be rather ethnocide, because the Russian discourse involves a negation of the idea of a Ukrainian nation as independent entity, and the negation of the possibility for a Ukrainian people to exist historically with its autonomous government and culture. Although some war crimes, such as the abduction and forced adoption of children, verge on juridical marks of genocide. Conversely, or inversely, the category of genocide or extermination with a genocidal dimension seems appropriate or inevitable to describe the catastrophe now taking place in Gaza and its meaning for the survival of the Palestinian people. It should be, therefore, no surprise that it is increasingly used not only by Palestinians who cry for help and sanctions, but by esteemed scholars, authorized spokespersons of the humanitarian organizations and United Nations agencies. I believe that the exceptional invocation by General Secretary Guterres of Article 99 of the United Nations Charter on December 6th can also be interpreted in that sense as a warning before the imminent genocide. Among the comparisons that come to mind are the genocidal massacres perpetrated by the Serbian forces against Muslims in Bosnia in 1995 and others. The crux of the problem is, of course, whether the combination of mass killings and deportations, which has now affected Gaza, however criminal from the point of view of international law, which is clear, ought to be considered a side effect of the project of eradicating Hamas as claimed by the Israeli government, or it forms the real objective of the whole military operation. There's ample evidence that the second is the case, arising not only from the declarations of Israeli leaders who promised a second Nakba, which could be achieved only through exterminist means, and dehumanized the whole population of the Gaza Strip. But the combination of the eliminations in Gaza with a brutal intensification of the murders, expulsions, and persecutions in the West Bank and Jerusalem. They are complementary elements of a policy no longer aiming at just or simply discriminating the Arab population in Palestine, for which the category apartheid has proved adequate, but finally creating a purely Jewish territory from the river to the sea, a long-term dream of the Messianic, the River Jordan to the sea, Mediterranean Sea, a long-term dream of the Messianic Zionist extremism now in power in Israel. October 7th only provided the window of opportunity, also in terms for this project, also in terms of winning the support of the Israeli population or its passive acquiescence, acceptation, and crushing the opposition. I want now to go deeper into the comparison, taking two successive steps. The first, we'll try to articulate the issues of right and justice with the specific history of each war, which is the basis on which we must rely in order to take side in the conflict, something that we cannot avoid lest we become complicit of historical crimes. The second, which, as you will see, will be much shorter, just a conclusion because I had overestimated the space I had. The second will try to locate the alliances and solidarities on which the protagonists rely within what I call a geometry of imperialism that could explain the antithetic situations in which the main victims of the war, namely the Ukrainian people and the Palestinian people, find themselves with respect to the geopolitical divisions of the contemporary struggles for hegemony. So in a sense, I try to look at the dynamics of the wars inwards and outwards. Let me begin with issues of rights and justice. As our starting point, we may consider the notion of just war, which is a notoriously contested notion. Each warring party, of course, always claims to be justified, either legally or by some sort of superior interest, a historic mission, a fundamental ideology, etc. Pacifists or supporters of nonviolence always, of course, reject the notion. No war can be just, even if it's forced upon us, and the imperative of nonviolence would impose absolute ethical limits to every project of resisting an oppressive order, a violation of one's life, liberty, and estates, in John Locke's famous definition of personhood, which can be extended from individuals to collectives. I will not embark on that discussion of principles, but simply adopt the point of view of international law as it was codified in the Charter of the United Nations from 1945. The only just wars are defensive wars waged against an attack or an aggression. It is therefore an absolutely dissymmetric concept. War cannot be just on both sides, although perhaps it can be unjust on both sides. This is where the difficulties begin, in fact, because the codification I'm referring to exclusively referred to the defense of states or political entities which can be assimilated to states. This leaves entirely or left entirely open the question of wars of liberation or wars which are waged by oppressed peoples, communities, or groups which are not organized and recognized internationally as states. Or even it would suggest, we're back in a sense to the discussion about terrorism, that such wars are by definition illegitimate or unjust. This is, of course, what the subsequent history of decolonization processes, and most of the time precisely violent processes or involving wars of liberation, has entirely recast. Their lesson is that we may consider as a just war a combat in which a community with a collective sense of identity, something not always simple, of course, to define or ascertain, historically attached to a territory, again, a complex notion from the point of view of exclusivity and borders or frontiers, expresses and defends a right of self-determination and self-preservation that is denied or threatened by an alien power, usually called an empire. And it applies with significant nuances to both the current war in Ukraine and the war in Palestine. The Ukrainian case could seem very simple, because it can't be reasonably denied that on February 24 of 2022, the Russian state, calling itself Federation, invaded the territory of an independent republic whose integrity and sovereignty it had recognized after the dissolution of the Soviet Union. The continuity of the cruel war now waged on Ukrainian territory derives from this initial aggression and has added to it, in the conduct of the war, other criminal dimensions which logically could be brought before the International Criminal Court. What makes things more complicated, however, is the fact that a more limited conflict had already been waged since 2014 in the border region of Donbass between local separatists and the central government of Ukraine, combining linguistic, social, and ideological reasons, a conflict which the Russian government presented as a civil war, and in which it intervened through military supplies and the entry of alleged volunteers on the side of its brothers. This was the very beginning of the war between Russia and Ukraine, leading to increasing militarization on both sides, especially after Russia had annexed the contested region of Crimea, legally a part of Ukraine, but largely inhabited by Russophones, supposedly leaning towards Russia. The annexation coincided with, very remarkable fact, with the democratic revolution in Ukraine, called the Euromaidan, which led to ousting from power some oligarchs with strong ties to the regime of President Putin, and initiated a process of negotiations in view of integration, the integration of Ukraine into the European Union and NATO, in direct opposition to the geopolitical interests of the Russian Federation. To make a long story short, at the risk of errors again and great simplifications, we might say that the Russian invasion in 2022 was based on a double rationale. It was an imperialist war, trying to rebuild the empire that had been formed over centuries under the Tsarist regime and sanctified by the messianic mission of Holy Russia, then secularized and expanded by Stalin under the name of communism, now being resurrected with the help of a virulent nationalist ideology that counterposes an idealized Greater Russia or Eurasia to the degenerate democratic West. And it was a preventive political war which sought to crush the liberal democratic orientation of the Ukrainian state before it could become a model for reformists in Russia itself, who would take advantage of the solidarities between the various post-Soviet regimes to challenge the combined power of the economic oligarchs and the authoritarian state in Russia itself. Putin, of course, being both a beneficiary of the corruption and a heir to the tradition of the secret police, which controlled the Soviet Union under Stalin and after him. For the Ukrainians, this double war creates a single existential threat. Their patriotic reaction, however, reinforced by the war, but also subjected to its hazards or vicissitudes in the long term, is rooted in the enormous complexity of a national sentiment that has continuously intertwined moments of independentist struggle and moments of integration into imperial or federal or quasi-federal constitutions, as we could label the politics of nationalities in the early Leninist period of the Soviet Union. In a significant, albeit not exclusive terminology, they, the Ukrainians, present their current resistance as a postponed war of independence combined with a process of cultural decolonization. This is an interesting formulation because it draws our attention to the fact that colonialism has been also intra-European in the framework of different imperial states, of which Russia, continued by the Soviet Union after what I would call the Stalinian counter-revolution, is only one, with special characteristics, of course, particularly a double expansion and subjugation of peoples towards the West and towards the Orient. In that sense, the broad issue at stake in the current war in Ukraine and the evolutions of the two nationalisms that it pits against one another, as I have argued elsewhere, is a new phase in the long European civil war and a decisive experiment in the governance of Europe's complex internal ethnic composition. Let us now return to the case of Palestine and its protracted war with Israel. A civil war as well, in a specific sense, since the population and the state of Israel, albeit arising from a typical process of colonization inspired by the Zionist ideology, have long ceased to form an external or foreign body in the space of historic Palestine, which they exclusively claim for themselves, but by force share with the Palestinians. This is even more the case since Israel, continuously expanding the colonization process, has created, in fact, de facto, a single political space where it is the only sovereign authority exercising direct and indirect rule, with the paradoxical exception of Gaza, which is, or rather was, before its current annihilation, at the same time, an enclave ruled independently and a penitentiary institution totally controlled and permanently punished for its acts of resistance, whether violent or nonviolent. As a question of two peoples competing for the disposition of the same land, the long war in Palestine formally opposes claims of rights, or simply rights, on both sides, each of them seeking to establish its legitimacy through a combination of historical narrative and strategic actions. Israel's legitimacy, which is effective in terms of its own political cohesion and its external recognition, rests essentially on three sources or foundations whose combination has proved extremely powerful. The first is imaginary. It is the Zionist, and before Zionism, the old Jewish conviction that the Jews today everywhere in the world are descendants of the people supposedly expelled from the Holy Land after the destruction of the Temple of Jerusalem, and who always dreamt of returning home. The second is the crucial fact that after the partition decided by the United Nations in 1947 and the victory of the Jewish army over the Palestinians and the Arab states in 1948, the state of Israel was internationally recognized by all camps, with the remaining important exception of the Arab states, who nevertheless increasingly cooperated with it economically. And it became a full member of the international community of nation states. And the third foundation, which is not juridical but moral and also political, derives from the fact that Israel has conceived of itself and appeared as a place of refuge, a sanctuary for the survivors of the Holocaust and other Jews persecuted in the world, which have no state of their own. Leaving aside for today the imaginary foundation in the origins of the Jewish people, I want to concentrate on the other two sources and their historical evolution. Of course, I must bracket many significant episodes and details which would impose qualifications, but I will submit the following analysis. Albeit strongly rooted in its juridical and moral sources, the legitimacy of Israel, or its right to rule over Palestinian territory and rename it, was always conditional. It could be verified over the long term only on the condition of being accepted by the Palestinians themselves, a condition obviously very difficult, if not impossible, to achieve, or only at the cost of some extraordinary political invention, and that in fact was never met. But not only it was not met, it was consciously and systematically destroyed in its very possibility. Over time, Israel has destroyed its own legitimacy. The result is a reversal of the initial situation, a radical delegitimization of Israel as a decent state, something which can give pleasure to its enemies but is also likely to have dramatic consequences, because it will increasingly push Israel towards claiming unconditional legitimacy or a right to defend itself at any cost, by any means, against any adversary or critique, which is what we observe today, and it began earlier. But let's be a little more specific. Israel's legal legitimacy rests on international declarations and acts, but it is bound, of course, to be contested from the beginning, because its territorial basis comes from colonization, both in the sense of the immigration or settlement into the country of foreigners of various origin and trajectory, and in the more conflictual sense of the grabbing of land taken from the indigenous population through various procedures of dispossession, which always ultimately involve force, even when they seem legal. Contrary to Golda Meir's infamous formula, Palestine was not and is not a land without a people for a people without a land. So legitimizing colonization is a huge paradox, increasingly so in the age of decolonization. But if it can be imagined as a way to move from partition to transaction, or as we would say in French, partage, sharing, cohabiting, and from partage to recognition or equal dignity, it would require a dramatic moral and political revolutionary change. Israel never embarked on that way. Not only it did not acknowledge that its appropriation of the territory on which to establish a Jewish state was opposable or questionable with right, but it expanded it to every part of Palestine, which the war allowed them to, the Israelis, to control, or it waged preventive wars to allow for this expansion, ultimately officializing the goal of Jewish rule over the totality of Palestine from the river to the sea, which had been heralded by its own extremists. With the help of powerful sponsors abroad, mainly the United States, of course, but not only, it could blatantly contradict international law in implementing the colonization of the West Bank and East Jerusalem. And as for Israel's moral legitimacy, resting on the mission to provide a sanctuary for the victims and survivors of the Holocaust, or a place where they could be liberated from statelessness and reclaim what the philosopher Hannah Arendt has called the right to have rights, it was also immediately questionable in the sense that it rescued masses of refugees at the cost of creating masses of others violently expelled, terrorized, and denied the right of return. Again, it would be verified only on the paradoxical condition of Jews subjecting their own citizenship or political membership to the creation of the citizenship of the others, which cannot be paternalistically conceded, but ought to become recognized as their own initiative and given its institutional conditions, be it in the form of a two-state solution or a one-state with multiple modalities of belonging. Equality or nothing, Edward Said famously called once one of his collections of political essays after Oslo. Not only Israel allowed no such process of equalization to begin, but it did the exact opposite, instituting discrimination and continuous harassment of the Palestinians, even when they had formal Israeli citizenship, which led to the creation of a state of apartheid over the whole territory. The notion of the sanctuary was reversed into what has been rightly called an ethnocracy, where Jews from everywhere can come to see themselves as privileged, a privileged or even a superior people, to which we may add the deplorable transformation of the memory of the Holocaust from a symbol of inhumanity, teaching lessons of political morality to every individual and every people in the world, into a kind of private instrument of domination and self-justification. This generates another devastating form of delegitimization. Now the question becomes, does the increasing delegitimization of the State of Israel, of which we are going to observe rapid developments in the wake of the current war, entail an increased legitimacy for the rights of the Palestinian people, or a greater verification of their own claim of rights? That is the key issue for the anticipation of a reversal of the tendency, a positive result of the ongoing transformation, however unlikely it may appear in the midst of the destructions and the apparent incapacity or unwillingness of mediating external forces to detain the catastrophe. It seems to me, however, that the answer is bound to remain ambivalent. It is yes and no. Anat, I must close.
It's okay.
Okay. A few minutes more. Do I have a few more minutes?
Sure. Yeah, go on.
Thank you. The answer is yes, indeed. Because the Palestinians have no need to become recognized or justified for their right to inhabit and work on the land where their ancestors have lived for generations. They have no need to become recognized or justified for their right to exist. The question is a practical one, not a question of normative conditionality, as philosophers would say. And?
Don't worry, it's someone who did not cut his microphone. Go ahead.
And from the practical point of view, it can be said that while the State of Israel and the majority of its population does not even admit that there exists something like a people of Palestine, with a national identity rooted in the past and forming a horizon and horizon of expectations for the future, the situation is rapidly evolving on the side of the public opinion in the world at large, which is a crucial condition for the constitution of Palestine as a political subject at the international level, for instance, in the form of full acceptation of a Palestinian state by the United Nations, be it a Palestinian state in exile that existed in history. What for a long period was proclaimed by peoples and more or less sincerely governments in the Arab and Islamic states, by the global left, including anti-imperialist citizens in the north, who viewed Palestine as the last great case of emancipation against the colonial principle after the end of the apartheid system in South Africa, is becoming now a very widely shared conviction, which transgresses barriers of civilization and language and tends towards universalization, I would say. But perhaps also the answer is no, because obstacles have accumulated before the constitution of the Palestinian people as an autonomous political subject, an effective agent of its own emancipation. The war as it unfolds now will certainly increase the feelings of solidarity within the people, but not necessarily its political capacity to act as one subject, one collective subject. Of course, this incapacity has been Israel's permanent objective. It has been brutally or insidiously imposed from above through repression, particularly the systematic imprisonment of national leaders, and through corruption. But it has also developed from inside. What has been admirable and politically meaningful in the history of the Palestinian people since the Nakba and through all the vicissitudes of the conflict before and after 67, before and after Oslo, across the intifadas, was the conservation of the moral unity and the spirit of resistance among the dispersed fractions of the Palestinian people, outside and inside Israel as a juridical constituency. But what has become increasingly problematic, despite remarkable attempts at reversing the course, like the prisoner's document in 2006, was the political unity of the organizations and figures representing the people as a force, asserting its place in history and giving it a public voice. With the almost complete subordination of the Palestinian Authority to the injunctions of the State of Israel, and the choice of Hamas to periodically make use of terrorist methods that create in the population as much anxiety or even repulsion as emulation and encouraging, this internal dissociation seems more insurmountable than ever, at least, I haste to add, seen from my external place of observation. Reason why I submit this with extreme modesty and hypothetically, asking in particular if and how third parties could emerge that overcome the rift and begin to create a solution. A last observation comes to mind when confronting lessons from the two cases that we discuss, Ukraine and Palestine, from the point of view of their place in a discussion on justice. Not only the justice that refers to their position in the war on one side of the other or the other of the divide between aggressor and victim or oppressor and resistant, but the justice that can acquire a universal resonance, the justice that confers a universalistic dimension upon the claim of rights that some actors embody in the war, not all of them, obviously. A striking similitude between the Ukrainian cause and the Palestinian cause that creates a virtual convergence among them comes precisely from the fact that they appear as incarnations of universal principles of self-determination and resistance to oppression, reason why in different parts of the world there are today activists who make valuable efforts to simultaneously support and articulate the two causes. However, this remains practically limited because they are also perceived as inseparable from geopolitical alliances and camps engaged in another kind of war, sometimes described as the new Cold War, of which they would form only partial aspects, local moments, or into which they would become inevitably absorbed. Paradoxically, because of the tension that tears apart the cosmopolitical realm between a point of view of the universal values and a logic of the global and the global relations of forces, the affinities between the just causes of peoples asserting their right to self-determination are not easily perceived or even denied by the supporters. For this reason, in a brief manner, much too quick, in fact, I want to devote some final considerations to the global dimensions of the two wars that I will subsume under the name Geometry of Imperialism, borrowed from the late economist and political theorist Giovanni Arrighi, one of the founding figures of alter globalization. The first thing that I would insist, this will be very, very short, that I would insist must never be forgotten is the fact that the essence of a political cause does not reside, never resides in their being associated with global oppositions between geopolitical forces rooted in economic interests and ideological systemic antagonisms. To believe the opposite is a negative legacy of campism, the political logic of the opposition between two camps inherited from the divides of the Cold War, to which I will return in a minute. This is why it is crucial to reconstruct the specific history of each war, each people, each territory in its own local terms, and to describe the modalities in which a war has developed out of conditions and choices that were made by their own actors, Russians, Ukrainians, Israeli Jews, and Palestinian Arabs, with all their internal divisions and their complete history. The assessment of justice does not derive from the fact that Ukraine rallies the world, the free world, or the world of democracies against a coalition of authoritarian regimes, or the fact that the Palestinian struggle for dignity and independence forms part of a global anti-hegemonic struggle now challenging the planetary domination of the United States. On the other hand, however, there is no such thing as an isolated action and transformation of any people in the world, today less than ever. This is clearly true for all the actors of the wars that we discuss, although with important, even radical differences. Contrary to what the Western coalition supporting Ukraine announced and wanted to believe, the war has not isolated Russia, economically, diplomatically, even militarily. Rather, it has created the possibility of a new system of alliances around it, which is perhaps fragile, but not arbitrary. And although it may appear a completely different problem, of course, that the Palestinian people is tragically isolated in the geopolitical environment because of the refusal of the American and European powers to impose obligations on Israel, which they compensate, particularly the European Union, through humanitarian aid, thus, in a sense, subsidizing colonization. But also because the official support of the Arab states for the Palestinian cause most of the time, or frequently, has proved to be essentially instrumental and self-interested. The fact is also, as I indicated a moment ago, that the Palestinian cause occupies a central place in popular movements of emancipation worldwide, which periodically challenge the established order. The Arab Springs come to mind. And the Palestinians themselves are part of a broad system of diasporic solidarities. However, it seems to me that the most interesting and difficult question regards the contradictory relationships of the two causes that I tried to cases, excuse me, that I tried to compare with the forces and the policies of American imperialism, an imperialism that perhaps is no longer unrivaled in the world, but still exercises a military and financial hegemony on which the outcome of the wars will completely depend. A simplified but eloquent formulation of the paradox would sound as follows, I propose. The bombs that destroy the houses and kill the people in Gaza are provided on a daily basis by the United States, just as the imposition of a ceasefire reclaimed by the United Nations is prevented by the continuous veto of the United States, which has immediately declared unconditional support for the right of self-defense of Israel after October 7th. On the Eastern European front, conversely, it is becoming increasingly visible that if the soldiers who die in combating Russian troops, also dying themselves, are Ukrainians with a few foreign volunteers, the weapons are now European and especially American. A cessation or even a limitation of their delivery, which depends, as we know, on hazardous political continuities, especially in the United States, would almost immediately entail a defeat of the Ukrainian people and a destruction or dismembering of their country, whose integrity they are defending. The US support to the Israeli war is in absolute continuity with a dependency of its existence and policy on American subsidy that and help that has been so strong over decades that at some point Israel could be described as a kind of external member state of the American Federation, albeit enjoying the capacity to impose its own priorities on its metropolis. Whereas the US and European support to the Ukrainian independence or decolonization is an outcome of the strategic moves that followed the collapse of the Soviet Union and the socialist camp. Hence, the transformation of the global divide between the capitalist and the socialist powers into a new struggle for hegemony among neo-imperialist states of unequal strength and with various internal political regimes. The conclusion to be drawn is that the current wars of extermination are effectively taking place within an imperialist geometry or structure, but they are not to be judged according to the old campist syntax, be it formulated in terms of a conflict between democracies and totalitarian states, or a conflict between the Western imperialism under US hegemony organized by NATO and the emerging peoples with a tricontinental basis in the South. We must invent a new cosmopolitical understanding of the world to orientate our solidarities with the struggles of the peoples who fight for their liberty and for them to navigate their alliances and enemies. Sorry to have been very, very long and perhaps boring. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks very, very much. It wasn't boring, I assure you. And that was really rich and interesting. Now,
you've always been extremely generous to me. Go ahead. No,
just telling the truth. Anyway, we do have some time for the questions here.
So I hope so.
Okay.
I take a pen. Okay.
Okay. Is that okay now? Okay. So can you comment on the contrasting choices made by US policy in these two cases, the cases you you compared? Can you comment on the political double standard of the USA and the EU regarding the two wars of Ukraine and Palestine?
What is the formula that is frequently used? I was thinking of commenting on it, and I thought I had already been too long. Of course, is double standards, and I completely agree that this double standard exists. And of course, I'm particularly sensitive, I would say, to the European dimension of that situation. Now, of course, there are all sorts of reasons that can be invoked. The post-colonial, therefore, in fact, colonial past of many European states, particularly the French, but not only, which was never really subjected to collective criticism and elaboration, is something that weighs very heavily. It could be observed, for example, when some time ago, refugees, Ukrainian refugees were accepted and welcome in Eastern Europe, while the Syrian refugees and other people from the Middle East were rejected like animals. But this extends also, I believe, to the way in which the public opinion and in Europe perceives the Palestinian, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. So their tendency to identify with the colonizer and to reject or neglect the colonized in the broad sense. This is an additional factor, but the two things are closely linked. Even more the case when, for a number of reasons, the public opinion in Europe is shifting, I would say, towards more conservative political positions. Now, the main factor probably, which is true for the not only for the European Union, but for the United States, is the fact that Israel plays and has played a strategic role in the global, in the organization, I would say, of the Western and especially the U.S. Hegemony in the Middle East, and this is not only true from the military point of view, but this is also true when we observe the so-called Abraham what's the term agreements agreements or the attempt at completely reorganizing the hegemonic system of states in the Middle East. So the problem is NATO, and the problem is the economic domination of the West in the Middle East, of which Israel is a strategic place. So as a now in the case of Ukraine, we have I'm not a strategic expert. We face a very complicated, I would say, polemical situation, because because Russia has justified its aggression in terms of replica, kind of again a preventive form of defense against what it described as the aggressive expansion of NATO, trying to encircle Russia and to conquer, to broaden its system of alliances in Eastern Europe, in Asia. I reject the idea that such a strategic expansion could justify the Russian aggression. I think it's a fake justification in that sense. Now, nevertheless, the idea that NATO is not just a defensive alliance, that it has its own perspective of expansion and superiority in that part of the world is something that I find totally undeniable. So in a sense, because I need to reach a conclusion, I believe that the Ukrainian people, I think that the integration of Ukraine into the European Union ought to be separated as much as possible. It's difficult, as much as possible, from the issue of the integration into the military alliance. But the tragedy comes from the fact that I tried to describe a moment ago, that Ukraine has no other way of defending itself than becoming integrated in the West's system of military defense, and this is all the more worrying for them. Not only because, again, I try not to fall into the banal anti-imperialist discourse, not only because they would become part of an imperialist system, but because the form and in which the West, and particularly the United States, imagine their commitment to the defense of the Ukrainian people is, I believe, in my opinion, whatever the ideological discourses or professions of faith, something that is purely conjunctural and self-interested. If the United States under this president or another president comes to the conclusion that the costs are greater than the strategic benefit, they will abandon the defense of the Ukrainian independence at all costs, and they will try and negotiate some sort of partition with the Russian with the Russian state.
Thank you. I'll have to.
These are my guesses. You know.
Yeah, it's all right. I'm skipping some of the interesting questions, so I'll pick some of them now. So the following one quotes Rashid Khaledi, and he has written with regard to the present war that
Rashid is with us. No.
No. But he's quoted in this question.
Somebody quotes him.
Exactly. And he quotes him saying
wonderful.
What happens in the hostile political media and institutional space in the US and the West that many of us occupy matters enormously. Now, the question is, how can we intervene effectively in this space when it is so hostile, not only to the legitimate demands of the Palestinian people, but also to clarity, often even to the possibility of coherent explanation and contextualization, as in the claim by Emmanuel Valls that to explain is already to justify. So could you comment on that?
I want to be extremely modest. You know, I'm not living in the United States. I traveled there from time to time. You indicated when generously introducing me that I had a position of visiting professor at Columbia, where Rashid precisely teaches and is a prominent figure of the academia. That doesn't give me a special lucidity. Huh? So I will simply refer to one of his writings, famous, the one I quoted before, and a recent experience of hearing him speak. That was in October at Columbia. I referred, and I have it here on my desk, to the very useful, very important, very remarkable book called The 100 Years' War on Palestine. That was, of course, finished a few years ago, 1 or 2 years ago. And if you read it entirely, of course, the description of the continuity of the not only the solidarity but the bond of mutual dependency between Israel and the US that began even before the official creation of the State of Israel and was continuously reinforced, and with a few exceptions such as the 56 Suez War, etc., provided Israel with the permanent capacity to develop its project of establishing the Jewish state as the only political power in Palestine. This is, of course, depressing. Nevertheless, what Rashid seems to believe at the end of the book is that the balance of forces within the public opinion in the United States is shifting. So he doesn't write, of course, soon the majority of the public opinion in the United States will have abandoned the unconditional defense of Israel in favor of a pro-Palestinian position. But he really seems to believe that the process is taking place, a shift of the American public opinion. And then I was in New York in last October, the second half of the month, immediately, of course, after the October 7th assault and massacres, and just before the invasion of Gaza, the bombing of Gaza was to begin. It was already clear that it would take place. And of course, Rashid sounded much more pessimistic. I wouldn't say desperate, but much more pessimistic for what regarded the capacity, the possibility of the Palestinian cause to win a broader support in the United States. So, what to conclude from there? We would need elements that I don't have, but perhaps we can admit that the situation is not a stable one. It's not a. You probably would be in a better position. Many of you would be better informed than me to speak about that.
Actually, Rashid himself gave a lecture in this forum in October. But it's a very, very few minutes we have, and a big question. So if you can just reply very briefly.
I try.
It's wonderful.
I try.
It's wonderful.
I'm
this
not good
wonderful
at that.
question.
I'm
and
not
this
very
will be,
good
I'm
at
sorry.
that.
I'm sorry for the other people
No,
who
I'm
asked.
not
We
very.
don't have time for that. So
Go ahead.
the last question is this one. What do you think about the issue of peace versus justice? Is peace with the absence of justice a better outcome
Thank
than
you for asking. Thank you for
to
asking
change
that
the status
question.
quo? Yeah.
Thank you for asking that
It's an
question.
amazing
Because
question, and I'd like to hear you.
in my initial plan, which what was crazy in a sense, that would have been the last point, and I never had the time to reach there. The young men and women, girls, who struggle or fight the violent police repression in the French banlieue or suburbs, you know, have a formula which they have made popular, which is if no justice, no peace. If no justice, no peace. And justice means, of course, a number of things, but essentially, in fact, a complete reversal of the social and political situation that makes their permanent discrimination and the denial of their rights possible. So I believe that such a formula applies very directly both to the situation in Ukraine and the situation in Palestine, although of course with different terms, and provided we leave open or we do not close with a simple and immediate answer the question how and in which institutional or legal terms justice can be achieved. But here I always come back to Edward Said's formula, which I quoted a moment ago, equality or nothing. That's the starting point. Then you have, and I stop there, because then you have the next issue, which is justice. And within justice, equality is a necessary condition for peace. Otherwise, you'll have the continuation of conflictual situations, and again and again eruptions of extreme violence. But the next question is whether that is enough. Whether that is enough. It's a necessary condition. You and me, we are teachers of philosophy, so we use this formula, and some here are mathematicians. The question is the question of the necessary and the sufficient condition. So I would not believe that justice is a sufficient condition for peace. And therefore, and then, of course, you'll ask what other condition is needed. And I would say in very general terms, it's an idea of the future. It's an idea of a different social and cultural order where differences are not instruments of discrimination and extermination, but possible means for civilization. So it's a utopia. It's a utopia.
Well, thank you very, very much for this broad lecture. That was really rich and amazing. So
thank you for your patience.
I know that was really tremendous. Thanks
okay.
very much.
Thank you, Anna. Thank you all. Thank you all. Thank you, everybody.
I'll just end by thanking,
thank you very much,
apart from Etienne, to Noumer Cassis for the simultaneous Arabic translation, to Scientists for Palestine. And
thank you. Thank you so much for the translation. Thank you.
And the next lecture, as you can see in our series, will take place on Wednesday, 10th January. It will be by John Hardy from University College London, and he will talk about Alzheimer's disease from analysis to treatment. Do join us there.